Hello, this is Khurram Nasir and you're watching Optometry with Khurram. And today's topic is about the pediatric refraction. You know very well that dealing with the children, dealing with the newly born is so sensitive, right? And it's so difficult and so complex, right? So let's make it easy in this video. We are going to learn about the emetropization, which is very, very, very important topic, right? In pediatric refraction, right? So what is emetropization? It is coming from the emetropia, and you know very well that what is emetropia. Emetropia is a normal eye, eye having a visual acuity of 6x6 or 20x20, right? There is no any refractive error in the eye, which is called the emetropic eye, and the person is called emetropic person, right? And the phenomena is called the emetropia. So emetropization is coming from the emetropia, right? So what is emetropization? Before learning about the emetropization, we will discuss different parameters refraction in the eye, right? Like the power of the eyeball, the total power of the eyeball, the total power of the cornea, the total power of the crystalline lens, and axial length of the eyeball, right? So if we talk about these different parameters, like the cornea has at birth, cornea has power of approximate value is 55 diopters, right? And the crystalline lens has approximate value is more or less 44 diopters, right? It's so high. And the axial length at birth is 15 to 17 millimeter at birth. I'm talking about the birth. These are the approximate values at birth in a newly born, right? The cornea has 55, lens has 44 approximate, more or less, or axial length is 15 to 17 millimeter, right? So these are, you can see that the power of the eyeball, the total power of the eyeball in terms of cornea and lens is very high, and the axial length is so small, right? It's a common sense in a newly born, the axial length of the eyeball will be so short, right? Like 15 to 17 millimeter. And the important point in this lecture is that every newly born baby which is delivered from his mother womb, he or she got the refractive error of plus to 6 diopters, and that is a normal value, right? Every normal newly born baby, when he or she will deliver from his mother's womb, he or she will carry the refractive error of plus 2 diopters or plus 3 diopters or plus 4 diopters or plus 5 or plus 6 diopters. These are the normal values. So at the time of birth, at the time of delivery, if your baby got refractive error of hypermetropia, that is normal. But the range is plus 2 to plus 6 diopter. This is the normal range. And if your child having a refractive error of myopia, right, this is not normal, right? The normal refractive error at the time of birth in a newly born is hypermetropia, and the range is plus 2 to 6 diopter. This is normal, right? This is very critical point in this lecture. And if your baby got myopia, that is not normal, then you have to perform some screening tests, right? So now let's learn the definition of the emetropization, which is our topic today, right? So emetropization, as I told you, that the cornea has so many power at the time of birth, the lens has so many power at the time of birth, and axial length is so small, right? So the normal in adult, in me and in you, the total power of the eyeball approximate is 58 diopters, and the cornea contribute from the total power is more or less 43 diopters, right? And the lens contribute 15 diopters. So the total power of the eyeball, the approximate value of the total power of the eyeball is 58 diopters, right? But in adult, but in case of newly born, the values are different. As we have discussed, that at the time of birth, cornea has 55 diopters, lens has 44 more or less diopters, and the axial length is so small, 15 or 17 millimeter, right? So we conclude that at the time of birth, right, the power of the eye is so high, right? So as the age passes, as the baby grows, then this power, this high power of hypermetropia will go decreased, right? The cornea will decrease its power, the lens will decrease its power, and the axial lens, which is so small, will grow up, right? So this process of shifting from ametropia towards emetropia is called emetropization, right? In a very simple way, again, when the cornea, which got very high power, will come to the normal value. For example, cornea has, at the time of birth, cornea got, as I told you, that 53 diopters, right? For example, approximate value is 53 diopters at birth. We are talking about cornea, but the normal power of the cornea in adult is 43 diopters, right? And the lens has, at the time of birth, 44 diopters, for example. And this crystalline lens is coming towards the normal power in adult, like 15 diopters, right? And at the time of birth, the axial length is 15 to 17 millimeter, which is not normal, which is so small. Then this axial length will grow and will shift towards the normal value, which is 24 millimeter in adult. So that shifting of cornea from this value to the normal value, the shifting of lens from this value to this value, right, towards the normal, and axial length, which is shifting towards the normal value, 24 mm, this shifting of ametropia towards emetropia is called the emetropization. I hope this is clear. And now we will discuss about the different types of the emetropization. And we have two different types of emetropization. One is the passive emetropization, and the second one is called the active emetropization. And now we will discuss about the passive emetropization. So in both the types of emetropization, like in active emetropization or passive emetropization, we have the eye has to come towards the normal, the eye has to come towards the emetropia, right? So now we are going to learn about the passive emetropization, the passive one, right? Remember one thing, that whenever you will read, whenever you will see, whenever you will write passive emetropization, a word should be click in your mind, and that is axial length, right? Remember it, axial length. You have to recall this axial length when you will study or read or write passive emetropization, right? So passive emetropization is totally connected with the axial length of the eyeball, right? You know very well that at the time of birth, the cornea has a maximum plus power, the lens has maximum plus power, right? But the axial length is so small, right? So in passive emetropization, the axial length will overcome the refractive error, right? If for example if the eye is high, surely the eye is hyperopic. So in hyperopic eye, in a newly born, if the cornea and the lens, as we have discussed, that cornea and lens has so many power in plus, right? Cornea lens has maximum plus power, right? So if the cornea and lens are not going to decrease its plus power so rapidly, then the axial length is the person who will increase rapidly, right? So for example, this is a hyperopic eyeball, which is so small, as you can see, right? And the cornea, this is cornea and this is lens, these two structures are not decreasing their power so rapidly. So we have only one option right now, and that is axial length, right? So light rays are going here, but the eye is so small, this is retina, right? Lights are not focusing over the retina because the eyeball is so small, and cornea and lens are not going to decrease their power so rapidly. So we have only one option, and that is axial length. So axial length will increase. So now the axial length will rapidly increase, and it will overcome the refractive errors, right? So if a hyperopic eye is there, right, and hyperopic eye is weaker, what does it mean when I'm saying it's weaker? It means that cornea and lens are not decreasing their power so rapidly. So in this case, the axial length will increase so rapidly, and when the axial length will increase, then automatically the light rays will go on the surface of the retina to overcome the refractive errors. This is called axial length. This is called the passive emetropization in hyperopic eye. And now we will discuss in myopic eye. right? In myopia, you know very well, myopia is not normal. And as I have discussed earlier, that myopia is not normal in newly born baby, right? So in myopia, if myopia is there, right, then myopia means the axial length is already increased from the normal, right? Myopia means the increase in the plus power, and the second definition of the myopia is increase in the axial length, right? The axial myopia, right? So if myopia is there, it means that the axial length is already increased, right? So in passive emmetropization and in term of myopia, the axial length will grow so slowly, right? Because in myopia, axial length is already increased. The axial length is already increased in myopia, right? And if axial length will grow rapidly, then it will increase the plus power, right? The light rays will not focused on the retina. So in case of myopia, in passive emmetropization, in case of myopia, the axial length will grow so slowly. Because why? Reason: because in myopia, the axial length is already increased, so there is no need to increase the axial length so rapidly. So in case of myopia, in passive emmetropization, in case of myopia, the axial length will grow slowly. And in contrast, in hyperopia, because the axial length is so small, so the axial length will grow rapidly. So in hypermetropia, the axial length will grow rapidly, and in case of myopia, the axial length will grow so slowly to overcome the refractive error, right? So our ultimate goal is to decrease that maximum plus power from the eyeball, and our purpose is to shift towards the emmetropia to overcome our refractive errors. So this is called the passive emmetropization. And now we will discuss about the active emmetropization. So the active emmetropization, now the active emmetropization. So remember, whenever you will study, as I said, whenever you will study, whenever you will read or write the active emmetropization, the first letter, the first word I must say, which should be clicked in your mind, and that is retina or retinal image, right? So in active emmetropization, the retinal image, the quality of the retinal image decides that your refractive error is going to decrease or not. Because in emmetropization, our prime purpose is to decrease the refractive error, to overcome the refractive error, to manage the refractive error, to treat the refractive error. This is our prime purpose, right? So in active emmetropization, the quality of the retinal image, so the image which is forming on the retina, right, the formation of that image, the quality of that image on the retina will decide that either refractive error is going to treat or not, either refractive error is going to decrease or not, right? So again, in active emmetropization, the quality of the retinal image will decide that the refractive error is going to treat, the refractive error is going to decrease or not. How? Remember one thing, that if, as you know very well, that this is very critical point, pay your all attention to me, that if you know very well that in a newly born baby, that the quality of the retina, the quality of the image on the retina is not good. Because why? The reason: because the power of the cornea, the power of the lens is so high, is maximum right now. This is not normal, right? Because our eye is hyperopic, right? And in any refractive error, the vision will be decreases, right? So as we have discussed, that in a newly born baby, the power of the cornea, the power of the lens is so high, so quality of the retinal image is not good right now at the age of newly born, right? So this blurred retinal image at the time of birth or after birth, at the this blurred image on the retina is actually the stimulus, right, which will drag the eyeball to shift towards the emmetropia. This is very important point. Remember it, that in active emmetropization, the retinal image will decide that either we are going to decrease that refractive error or not. If, for example, at birth, as I told you that at birth there is hyperopia of plus 4 diopter. For example, a newly born baby is freshly delivered from his mother's womb, and he or she got refractive error of plus 4 diopters, right? Try to understand. So at this time the refractive error is plus 4 diopters, and obviously that if any patient, either it is newly born or either it is 60 years of age, if anyone got plus 4 diopters of hypermetropia, the image on the retina is not good. The image on the retina is blurred, right? So right now the image is blurred. So that blurred image is actually the stimulus for the eyeball, for the brain, to decrease the plus power of the eye, to decrease the plus power of the cornea, to decrease the plus power of the lens, right? If the retina will gain the clear image, right, then there is no any reason to decrease that plus power of the cornea, then there is no any need to decrease the power of the lens, right? So if, for example, a newly born baby is there and he or she got plus 4 diopters of hypermetropia, and you checked the eyesight and you see there is a refractive error of plus 4 diopters, let's treat that hypermetropia of plus 4 diopters, and you prescribe him glasses of plus 4, right? Remember it, you prescribe him glasses of plus 4 diopters and you treat his or her hypermetropia. This is the biggest mistake ever with the child, right? How? Remember that when you prescribe plus 4, he or she, the newly born baby, he or she needs plus 4 diopters of hypermetropia or plus 4 diopters of spherical lens, and you prescribe him, then what does it mean? It means his or her retina will get sharpest image, right? And image and retina will say to the brain, Mr. Brain, I am getting the clearest image right now, and you no need to decrease the power of the cornea. You do not need to decrease the power of the lens. There is no any need to decrease the power of the cornea and the lens. So brain will say, okay my dear, I'm not gonna decrease the power of the cornea, I'm not gonna decrease the power of the lens, right? And you know very well that right now we have disturbed all the emetropization process. I hope you understand. This is called the active emetropization, right? In this case, right, in active emetropization, that's why we do not treat all the refractive errors in newly born or 1 year or two years or 3 years of age group, right? We will discuss it in detail in upcoming few minutes, right? I hope you understand the proper definitions of emetropization, the proper definition and proper appropriate explanation, understanding regarding the active and passive emetropization. And in the very next lecture, we will discuss that how we can treat the refractive errors from newly born to 3 years of age group, from 3 years to 5 years of age group, and from 5 years to 10 years of age group. So stay connected and keep watching. See you in the next videos.